Joining us right now, Charlie Kirk, whose new book, The MAGA Doctrine. I'm a third of the way through it, believe it or not.
I'm a third of the way through it.
I feel like I am crazier now and have more things to do now that we're all supposed to be staying home than not. But obviously, Charlie's with TPUSA, and he's with Students for Trump. And welcome. It's good to see you.
Thank you. Great to see you. Absolutely.
I hope you're doing well with the lockdown, although now it looks like we're starting to sort of reopen. However, the DNC was saying, no, we're going to reopen too quickly. And this is all about really ultimately putting profits above people. But Charlie, I mean, how hypocritical do you think this is? Because aren't they ultimately saying already by declaring people to be essential or non-essential that you're okay with an amount of lives being risked just so you can have a pizza delivered as opposed to go get it? I mean, it seems hypocritical to me.
Well, look, their entire argument hinged around the idea or the presupposition that the pending crisis was so great that whatever cost associated with the lockdown would be worth it, that the price of the lockdown would be worth it. Well, that's actually proven to be questionable, if not false, to the extreme of the draconian measures that some of these governors took. The models have completely fallen apart. We were promised that the lockdowns would actually work. And there's a lot of evidence that the now cure is might actually been worse than the virus. Dana, you've been a great fighter for a word that I don't hear enough about, liberty. When you have liberty, there is always a cost associated to it. So, for example, you talk about the Second Amendment better than probably anyone else in the movement. You talk about the right of gun ownership to be able to protect yourself is worth it, that you're going to have, unfortunately, people make mistakes, accidental discharges. People are going to abuse that freedom. But that's not an excuse to infringe upon that freedom. And so what we've seen in the last couple of weeks is a narrative that total and complete safety absolutely must happen with no cross-examination, no discussion whatsoever to try to protect people. We have seen alcoholism increase. We've seen social isolation increase. We've seen drug usage increase. We've seen suicide increase. And we've seen businesses be shut down, families completely be torn apart. We've seen spousal abuse increase. We've seen child abuse increase. So my question is, if it's about health, which it should be, why don't we take a more comprehensive view of all the costs associated with it, Dana? And the final point I'll make is this, is you have these governors that for years have tried to argue, well, we need marijuana legalization because we really care about people should be able to make choices. And, you know, sure, people might abuse that. Yeah, we shouldn't go after people on the side of the street in San Francisco that openly use drug usage and, you know, use syringes. And all of a sudden they were like the big ambassadors for freedom and liberty for years. Where have those Democrats gone? They have become total totalitarians that said, wait, weren't you the ones like 3 years ago or 3 months ago that you said you should be able to do whatever you want on the streets of San Francisco, from public defecation, from, you know, syringes in your arm to you'll set up a tent on the side of the street? Now you can't even leave your home. They see this as the greatest socialist power grab in American history and a gateway to statist and collectivism. I believe it's the greatest violation of individual rights in American history, and we have to do something firm and peaceful, of course, to push back and rebel against this.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, you, as we're talking with Charlie Kirk, and you're involved with Students for Trump, and my oldest son, who is a college freshman, is, I guess you would say, an older Generation Z member. And you're like a younger millennial. You have younger millennials. You have Generation Z. A lot of people are coming to of age in this, during this pandemic. I mean, you have college seniors, high school seniors, who have been robbed of these benchmarks. And some people might think, oh, that's such a first world problem, graduation, et cetera. But really, these are life shaping things that take place. These are benchmarks in life. And I'm wondering the effect that it's having on this generation, whether or not it's going to impact how they view socialism, communism, especially now that it's really prevalent in media. And I think thanks to the administration really hitting this hard every single time that the president's in front of a camera, that this is what happened with China. This is as a result of censorship, stopping doctors and journalists from trying to warn the public about this virus. And so my son had made mention to me, because he, you know, he's missing out on a lot of opportunities this summer. His friends are missing out on graduation. He's missing out on sports, things like this. And they all honestly seem pretty peeved at China about this, Charlie. So I guess in your working with Students for Trump, what are you seeing from these generations that ultimately, I think, are really paying a high price for this during this lockdown.
Yeah, look, as you know, I'm a huge advocate of the president, and I think he's doing a phenomenal job for our country. He was put in an impossible situation here. And look, young people should be upset at China and the Chinese Communist Party. But more broadly, they should be upset at the entire political system. And President Trump is an exception to this because he has operated as an outsider despite being an incumbent. It's something we've rarely ever seen in American history. But young people, they look at the $2 trillion bill passed through Congress, $6 trillion with leverage, and the hyperinflation that will probably ensue for our generation and the debt and deficits that will be put on our back. And they say, wait a second, airlines got bailouts. The big companies are going to have access to liquidity, free cash for people, but not college kids or high school kids. They ask themselves, why is the political class and the ruling class continually not representing our best interests? These are the same people that said China is our friend. We shouldn't question them. And I don't think it's insignificant that young people are having summers robbed away from them and their graduations robbed from them. Anyone who cross-examines that, they themselves, they are trying to impart their own value system and trying to violate other people's freedoms and liberties and trying to diminish what young people care about most. And so what troubles me the most, Dana, is that we have a political system and a ruling class that has been set up that, quite honestly, could not care less about our generation. They don't care about your son. They don't care about me. And guess what? It's Republicans and Democrats. It's not just one side. It's mostly Democrats. They all don't care. But far too many Republicans have gone along with the status quo of endless debts and deficits, of reckless spending, of crony capitalist bailouts. And so your son's feelings are spot on. And then you add on to it, this generation, our generation, is about to graduate from college. You have 5 to 6 million people that are going to graduate from college in the next 3 weeks. They're not going to be able to walk for a ceremony, most likely. They're going to be robbed of that special moment. And they're going to enter the worst job market in American history, bar none. Worse than the Great Depression, worse than the 1980 financial stock crisis, worse than Black Tuesday, worse than the 2008 financial crisis. And then you're trying to tell me that we have to continue our $1.2 million visa strategy every single year when our own college kids can't even get jobs. And so young people are looking for a champion. President Trump is going to continue to be that champion. But they look more broadly at Republicans and Democrats. They say, what is the difference anymore? And this is the opportunity for President Trump. It needs to be a choice, not an echo. Bold colors. He can say, I stand for limiting immigration, for the best interests of your generation, holding China accountable, and getting you back to work. And that will be so refreshing for a generation that rightfully feels lied to by the political ruling class.
I think that's a great point. And this is all on the heels of so many headlines leading into the election that, oh, it's the younger generation. They're going to be more inclined towards socialism. That's why Bernie Sanders had such a real young demo as his base. But look how people go where their financial, they go where, the, I mean, honestly, they vote their 401ks, they vote job opportunity, they vote taxes, and the younger generation is no different. I keep thinking of the story, too, and I'm sure you saw it, Charlie. In California, they were filling up these skate parks with sand, and you had these like high school kids that went out, and they turned one of them into a dirt bike path, and then they shoveled all of the sand out of the other one and continued skating. Like, that is such a great example, I think, of this younger generation. I sort of feel like China and ultimately communism and statism and this garbage that we see going on with Democrats and even Republicans here, they've awoken a sleeping giant in this younger generation.
And that's exactly right. So for years, I was a little bit upset that my generation and your kids' generation, which is not too far apart, Gen Z and millennials, they didn't really understand the Soviet Union that was being taught in school. They didn't understand Venezuela. Well, right now, Dana, for the rest of my public advocacy, I could say, did you enjoy being able to sit at home and go through the same Netflix shows and not be able to leave your house and have your opportunity robbed from you? You have now lived through Marxism. It's that simple. You have lived through Marxism. Guess what? They sent you free money to survive. Yeah, you could go smoke a bunch of weed in your house and you wouldn't get caught. Great. Sure, the liquor store to stay open. But if you were a Christian, you couldn't go to church for Easter. If you want to start a business, you couldn't even leave your house. If you wanted to go to the beach, they'd probably arrest you. If you wanted to go ride a boat in Michigan, the Eva Peron type, Governor Whitmer, would come and, you know, throw you in prison. Now they've lived it. We have a reference point. It's no longer just like charts and graphs and socialism, and they're eating garbage in the streets of Venezuela, and they're eating zoo animals, which is all true, by the way. I'm not diminishing that. But now, Dana, we have a data point. We can look young people in the eye and say, if you did not enjoy that, which you, by the way, if you enjoyed that, then you're fine. You're a Marxist. I'm sure 15 to 20% of young people love nothing more than endlessly sitting at home and not having to work and receiving money in their account and pursuing mediocrity. I will happily debate that, because 20% will say that, and then 80% will say, no, I actually want to be able to hike, start a family, do what I see fit. We now no longer have to talk about theoretical. And I always look at the unintended consequences and a blessing in disguise. If anything, that's a blessing in disguise for a generation that, quite honestly, lived in a Western capitalist country for their entire life and knew no different. But now they've lived a soft form of Stalinist socialism. And I don't say those words slightly, but if you look what's happening in some of those states, it is no different than what happened in the Soviet Union. How dare you leave your house? We're going to arrest you. We're going to fill up the skateboarding parks. It's really historically never happened before in the history of America. And I think, Dana, there's an opportunity. If we do our job and we don't act like moderate Republicans that just want to appease the other side, we could have a revolution of freedom-loving young people that will reject socialism and embrace liberty for decades to come.
No, I think that's well put. And definitely on that as well. I wanted to play for you really quick, last thing for you. This was Audio Summit 25. Elon Musk, he was on a call with his company, and he's being kind of dragged by some in the press and some politicians because of what he said here. Take a listen to this.
You know, this is a time to think about the future, and also to ask, you know, is it right to infringe upon people's rights as what is happening right now? I think the people are going to be very angry about this and are very angry. If somebody wants to stay in their house, that's great. They should be allowed to stay in their house, and they should not be compelled to leave. But to say that they cannot leave their house and they will be arrested if they do, this is fascist. This is not democratic. This is not freedom. Give people back the damn freedom.
I mean, this is making me kind of want to get a Tesla, Charlie.
Well, look, you know what's so funny about it? I mean, I've always been somewhat of a moderate Elon fan, because I just love people that take big risks and just bet on themselves. And I think there's something admirable about that. And I wish more people did that. I've actually not always liked his politics, because I thought he always pandered over to the environmentalist crowd. I will go buy an Elon Musk hat or whatever after this, because that took so much courage. I was on a shareholder call with all like the ruling class people that dare to be so politically correct. And he's right. I mean, this is a guy that just naturally came to this conclusion, and of all people, and by the way, if you want to win young people over, try to demonize Elon Musk. They literally look at him as Tony Stark, okay?
Oh, yeah.
He is our Bruce Wayne and Tony Stark, okay?
My son, wants to visit the factory for vacation.
And good. And by the way, they see something in him that they don't see in the left, which is entrepreneurial, ambition, risk-taking, vision, the stuff that we embrace as a country. He's a hero. And again, I don't like his environmentalist stuff, and I don't like the crony capitalist stuff, but that's irrelevant. It's not even worth, you know, getting into. What's admirable about what he's saying is that takes courage, that takes conviction, and he's correct. And that's how we're going to win young people over, is elevating voices like that, which Elon Musk is not a political voice. He's just trying to basically make innovations and make the world a better place and achieve things that no one's achieved before. And he sees this for what it is. He sees Newsom. He sees Cuomo. He sees Whitmer. He sees Evers from Wisconsin being the quasi-liberal fascists as they are. And again, I think Jonah Goldberg has kind of gone off track a little bit in recent years. But one of the most instructive books to understand why the left is acting the way they are is Liberal Fascism from back in 2010 to 2011. He lays this out. He says, when there is a crisis, the liberals will shut everything down. He said it so clearly in the book. It's because they can't resist themselves. Because once you want to say you want government to take over healthcare, take over schooling, you think when their crisis comes, they're going to tell you not to leave their home? It is a direct connection from leftism to fascism. God bless Elon Musk for pointing this out. We need more people and more corporate titans to have the courage that Elon had. And guess what? Tesla's share price went up after that. So that tells you something.
Oh, yeah, that does tell you something. And again, I've never, ever wanted to get an electric car. And it's to the point where I'm thinking, I'm actually like, okay, I think I'm going to have to start looking at a Tesla now. I can't believe this is how you make me your friend. You sit here and talk about liberty and freedom. I know we got to get going. But Charlie Kirk, the book is The MAGA Doctrine. Go and read it. It's at Amazon. And I want to add, too, I know that you guys were kind of getting bit at in the press. And, of course, you have friendly fire in the press because they were talking about the PPP stuff and all of that and TPUSA. And you guys made a point about not accepting any kind of government money. And I have to say, I think it's a little bit unfair the way that some, even on the right, kind of snip at you guys, because these are people that are a little bit holier than thou. And instead of being combative, you think that they might be a little bit more constructive. So I just, you know, I get a little, I had to say that while you were here on the program.
Thank you, Dana. I appreciate that.
Good to see you.
Truly. Thank you.
Charlie Kirk, good to see you, my friend. The MAGA Doctrine. Go and get it. Go. I actually am my third way through it. I'm I've been reading, right? Instead of playing Borderlands all day.